So, we now look here at the data of the supply module. The question for Rolando said, I mean, this is tremendous work, yeah, and a lot of data. So that's why we are also not selling this database, yeah, because each project, yeah, you start with Capri, you start with analyzing if the data are right. Yeah, I mean, you can imagine that's not so easy, yeah, to have all the details checked and validated. Yeah, so that's why it's quite important, given that we have algorithm routines behind data treatments, and then it's important to check before you start with your application. As example, for our case with the Russian import ban, we have to check if there are certain trade flows in line with the latest statistics, yeah? As example. Yeah? So if this is not the case, we need then certainly to update something if we really want to have a kind of policy report for the commission, as example, or for our national ministries. Nevertheless, data is important and it's used. Here we are looking at the supply module. As said, we will understand a bit the structure of this data cube. Yeah? We will also load the executing a small program from our database or our database cube, one particular region, yeah, in GEMS, and then you will check the data, and you have there's a small quiz. You will fill out that, and we will at the end have a good understanding of so how this data cube is structured. I will start here again with what is this didactic representation of a, let's say, our supply module. Yeah, we have here different activities, and it's important that you understand that different activities and products exist. So what is the activity in the meaning of an LP, and also here in the context of the supply modules in Capri? An activity is something what the farmers is doing on the field or in the barn. Yeah, so it means he is producing over one particular hectare wheat, yeah, and what kind of products can he produce with that? It's clear. I mean, he can produce corn, yeah, in form of wheat corn, but he's also producing straw. Yeah, it's getting a bit more complicated if you look at the animals, because a dairy cow can produce a lot of different things. Yeah, so the activity is the dairy cow, but the products, yeah, from a dairy could be, yes, milk, of course. It could be also milk for feeding. It could be at the end when it was slaughtered. Yeah, it could be the beef of this cow. And of course, he's also producing manure. And is also producing calves from time to time. So a lot of different products. And particularly in beef, you see that there are a lot of activities a farmer can do who are producing at the end beef. It could be like beef fattening activities, or also dairy cows are producing beef. Yeah, so that's why it's you need a clear understanding between these two terms, yeah? Activities of a farmers and also the products you are producing. So just that you're not getting completely confused. So here in this presentation, we look now at this green part. So where are the parameters and data are coming on, we feed in. And this is also more or less often the part what we are shocking. Yeah. So as example, if we are have a certain feed requirements, if you would like to shock the yield, if you would like exogenous to shock the price, yeah, everything is here somehow in the data, yeah, hidden. Yeah, and so that's why it's also important that you have at least a scene for one particular region, so how the data look like. So, yeah, we start here in 1989. So you have here this data parameter. You learned also from David's session and also from the session last week. So there's a parameter. So this is the classical container for storing data in GEMS, yeah, with a lot of dimensions. Here we have four dimensions. GEMS allows nine different dimensions. So what this means is like a vector. So, and we have here the region as a dimension. So here we are pointing just to, I think it's Saxony DED. Then we have a column. Yeah, this points to this part. So the column of wheat, the activity of barley, of dairy cows, and so on and so forth. Then we have rows. Oh, we have probably, it's animated, sorry. So then we have columns here, this one like potato. We have rows, yeah, like the hectares, but the end use, but also the products. And we have here indications, so to say, what are the years, yeah? And the first thing in Capri, which also was completely difficult to understand why in Capri we are also using always this why. Yeah, if you are doing the simulation, you will see that. Yeah, if you're doing simulation, then later on in the exercises in the data cube, we are using always why here. Yeah, for the baseline point. So in 2 and 2030. And the issue is easily explained. Yeah, this kind of time dimension was not foreseen when we started. Yeah, with the Capri model. And if you have a lot of dimensions here in your model, yeah, it's also getting slower. Yeah. So what we are doing, so you see that here is a just one of in the supply module Maria introduced is one equation, very easy equation saying you that more or less the sum over all the activities, yeah, who are producing young animals, yeah, should more or less be used. Yeah, this is a sum up equation for young animals. So all the piglets and the chickens and young calves and so on are here just calculated as like a balance. And if this balance is not possible, then you can buy or you can sell these young animals. I mean, this is then on the top. But nevertheless, you see here this data parameter we are using. Yeah. All the variables are starting with V underscore. So these are flexible. Yeah, they are not, they are, cannot be directly impacted. This is the outcome of our model. You know, so that how many young animals are bred or produced is an endogenous variable. So, but exogenous is the data here. And you see, we are using this Y here. Yeah, so the dimension Y and why it means that we are copy that for 2030 all the data on this dimension, yeah, to make it fast and easy, just that you understand from time to time if you look at this particular data cube why this is often used. This is a big disadvantage also, because yes, you need to know where you are when you analyze the data. Yeah, if you run your data for a baseline in 2030, then this Y is attached to 2030. So, and if you run the baseline in 2050, this Y is also indicating 2050. But you do not, I mean, you do not know it directly. I mean, you have to know what you're running from your settings in the graphical user interface. Okay, just to let you know how the structure is. So we now know here more or less that all the regions are simulated. Yeah, Torbjörn yesterday introduced that already. This figure is quite important. So we had also this repetition here over the iterations and the market integration. So this global market model is run. We have here a good understanding for the supply module, so where the different equations and variables are listed from the supply model. And we now in this exercise look at the data cube. Yeah, we have one big GDX file where all the data is stored. It's called SimInI GDX. It's stored, if you look at your result folder at CapMod, load SimInI, at CapMod, SimInI GDX, and it's created in this folder here during the GEMS execution in CapMod, load SimInI GDX.gms. We will have a look at this, yeah, in this small exercise with the breakout group soon. Now I introduce you to again this this matrix we are using. This is a summary of the complete matrix. We have, of course have no time to look in detail. So what I explained to you right now is that we have a column here. The columns are activities, and that we have products, outputs. So I just explained to you a bit this part. So, but we have for the activities also inputs, yeah, like fertilizer use, NPK use, pesticide use, seeding, and so on. And then we have additional here activity levels. It means how many of these activities exist in hectares or slaughtered heads or in herd sizes. And then we have secondary products. And then we have a lot of other calculations we are doing for this supply modules by region and by year, yeah, as this farm and market balances, yeah, also the prices position from the EAA and a lot of environmental indicators. So it was, this is a storing a location where all the different working groups around Capri are just storing their particular data. Yeah, so it means it's really a dynamic animal and it's also expanding depend on the project and what we are doing. Yeah, but this is the general outline. So this is the first exercise. Please find the data parameter definition in the CapMod file, the line, and then the second question is in which line this load sim ini gdx.gms is included. Yeah, so you for this exercise we will do that. You will do that by yourself and just let me know. Yeah, the line. Then I show you more or less and repeat that, and then we come to the next exercise. You have 5 minutes. Probably you are able now to do that in 2 minutes, I think. So the first one who has the right answer gets an easy question in the exam. At least the first question. No, was a joke. So look at the CapMod. Yeah, go to your editor, look at the CapMod file, and then search for this statement. As yesterday David explained you, if you want to define a parameter, then you have this parameter in data, and then let me know so what is the line number. And the line number can be seen at the bottom, I think, depends on your editor. Cora, okay, I will do that. So we have a 280 for the first from Antonia, yeah. So the data parameter, yeah. Is that interesting? Okay, should we check that together? Yeah, maybe you can also just a bit understand the way I'm doing it. Maybe from time to time it can be helpful if I can access the server. That would be nice. In a second. So I can also answer the second question in the meantime when I'm trying to open the server here again. From time to time the resolution is so bad. So hope it works now. Yes. So now I will try to share my screen with you. I think I need to. So which this one? Is the resolution okay? And can you see something, or is it too small? Let me know.
We can see your pink screen and it's quite small.
With icons or with no icons?
With icons.
Okay, maybe we take another one. Maybe we take this one. Okay, so let's. So now you should see an explorer, huh? Yes?
Yes.
Yes.
All right, this is good. So we have our create user interface. We started here in the start batch. We learned yesterday already that in run scenarios, all the files here, which can be run here, this does not fit. Now it fits, huh? It's quite laggy, but I don't know why. Okay. From time to time, you wonder with this task here, what is executed? And what you can do is just wait here for this start GEMS, and then you will see the information, what kind of file is started from your GEMS folder. Yeah? So what we can expect, why is my, who is running something on the server here? David, is also lucky in your case?
No.
Or maybe, now it comes up. Okay. So when you wait here, you see directly, so to say, what kind of file is executed. We see, we can confirm that this file, when we start here, is capmod.gms is executed. We also learned yesterday that we can compile it, so it went through here. And there's also a click on this area here, so a mouse click on the right. So then you have the possibility, if you have defined in settings editor, you can directly jump into this GEMS file. Yeah? You see here, this is capmod, yeah, in GEMS capmod. And this is a quite old editor. I have got used to it, yeah, since my PhD time. So that's why I'm using this. And you can here also search for this parameter, yeah. And you can also then search for data. So all the lines should be filtered here in this editor. And in my case, it's 280. So you're somehow right for those who have 280. I cannot see the chat, but I think the first guess was right. Yeah. Okay. You have seen that here. Interesting to see is we defined it here, and of course this definition does not mean that we have any data in. Yeah, so it's just a definition, it's a complete empty parameter. And interesting also to see here is we are allowing only the sets or the elements here which are under columns and rows, they are identified in the set schemes before. So if you have an interest to look at this, you have to go in this set elements, it's called set schemes, it's included here before. Yeah. So here,
excuse me, yes? Just 1 second, because there were some results that were shifted just one line. Is that can you tell us why this is? For example, the two of us, we had 280 and 281. Is that a problem, or is there a reason for it, or could we just neglect it?
I think as long as everything runs, we could ignore that. Yeah, maybe you have introduced a space yesterday or whatever. And maybe I have done it yesterday. I do not know. Yeah, okay. I mean, we have this versioning system which always allows you, at least in my case, to check if I have changed something. I can do that maybe later. Yeah, but you should have detected this line. Just to understand that this is the data parameter we are defining. And the second question was, where the data is loaded in here. Yeah. I have now to somehow find my presentation. So we look for load sim ini. Yeah. So this means that we have here a statement. Of course, here we have 219 lines not displayed. So in your case, you have to scroll a bit, but this editor allows you a bit to filter. And this is, so what kind of line number you had? Cora, what was the line number you had?
501 and 502.
Yeah, exactly. Huh? So it seems that there's a condition here. We know that if then else somehow create this file or not. But here's the include statement, as David then said, under a certain condition, this data should be loaded in. Yeah. And we can also have a look at this particular, I have to go to my, this particular, training session, GEMS, I've just set here so that we can jump into this file easily. So, and then you see here what we are doing is that we are loading in this data here. This is a statement, is that execute load during execution, we load from our folder, sim ini, Yeah, depending on the resolution we are working, depending on the base year, depending on the projected year, and some other modes, we are loading in here the data. Yeah? So this is a very easy statement. And you see, we are loading in a lot, not only this data, but we load also some other parameters, variables. And if the marked model is on, then we are loading even more. Yeah. And then you see, we load a lot of data up to here. Yeah. Here it ends. Yeah. So, and of course, this is very unpractical to have a look now here in. So that's why we have a small additional exercise. So now I have to stop that and come back to the presentation. So who was not able to find it? This was an easy issue, huh? Okay. So what do you see now? Everything probably. So this is the presentation. You see that again?
Yes.
Okay. This is the second exercise. It's a bit more. So the idea is of this exercise that we are extracting out of this file, this sim.ini, so which is stored in this CapMod folder. We are extracting just one data slide for one particular year and for one particular region. Yeah. So you can use GEMS IDE or Studio, whatever, just create a project, and the project needs to point exactly to the GEMS folder. It should be in this GEMS folder. So the relative path should refer to the GEMS folder of your training session. Yeah. You can do that here if you want, by just creating a project, exactly giving a certain name, create new name, in the IDE. I think there is a similar option also in Studio. Yeah? This is not a problem. And if you use the comment line, you can also use the comment line, but be then located in the GEMS folder so that we can use the code snippet I have provided for you. So then take this code snippet here, so which is available in the wiki. You can directly copy this out of the wiki. So there's an exercise, and you should be able to copy it from this code part. Put that into a new file in the GEMS folder and execute it. Yeah. So this is the not the full exercise, but we will first look at what will you execute. Yeah. Here, there are some settings that we had. It's required in sets. So that's why we are pointing you to your temp directory. I hope this exists in output. So that's why it's important that you also are in this GEMS folder executing this file, which you're creating. Yeah. Then we have included here all the set definitions. And here we select, please carefully look to understand what we are doing here. We are selecting, filtering, so to say, from this big data cube, just one region. It could be France, could be Cyprus, could be, I do not know, but at least for our exercise, what I'm asking you for, we have chosen one region here in Germany. And also we are only interested in the current, so 2030 simulation. So then we are creating our own data parameter, out of our region. All the columns which are defined here in sets and rows, so activities and so on, and the time. Yeah. And then we load in here exactly from the same location as you normally would load in Capri. This out of this this current database file for 2030. Yeah. You might be a bit asked. So sim.ini means that all the simulation initialization databases is stored in this data, and it's for NUTS 2, so that's why we have the 2 here. Then it's base year is 12 and the target year is 30. Yeah, so this is the nomenclature of this data name. We load that in. We're doing some calculations here, some easy ones, saying, okay, for all activities, we know that levels point to hectares or herd sizes. We multiply that with the yields of each of these products. Then scale that to calculate here the total cross production at farm level. This is just as we are normally are doing. So it's quite powerful because with such a statement, you can make a calculation of more or less for all the regions and all the years at once, with only one small statement. And it's very, very fast. So that's why we are also not using R or whatever, because this is from the performance is still the best what you have on the market. And then we execute unload that, our result file, and put this this new data file here. And then you open it with the GEMS IDE if you want, And then we have a nice small, okay, I have to go there. We have a clue for you, a clues. So a kind of gap filling text, where you look at the different dimensions and numbers and you fill them in, So for this, I split you into three groups. Back, first group would like to present the results. So what have you achieved?
Who is the first group?
The first group is Felix group. Felix. Well, just let us know so what you have find out.
Found for the code DED000, which is Saxony. The yield of rapeseed is 4,870 kilograms. We need 188.305 kJ of nitrogen and plant rejection costs 98.07 euros.
Okay.
The high technology yield was 10,403 kilograms, and there are 81K high and low yielding cows, but the question was that because that was exactly the same number for both of them.
Yeah, it's interesting. So that's why we pointed at this part. So this is something what you are doing quite often in LP programs, so that you split the activities. Yeah, if you have not a clear indication from, so you have an average price and an average yield. Yeah. So, and you have a distribution around this average saying, okay, half of it with this distribution belongs to low and half of it belongs to high. So you will see then later on the reaction. So on average is exactly what we are observing in the statistics. But if you have two activities we are presenting in this LP, a high and a low activity, then you have responses also with respect to prices on the intensity. Because it will be different if you have a low animal, which has low outputs, a bit more higher costs or comparable higher costs, then it reacts differently. And then the average again, gives you a kind of yield response also, because then the average yield of this dairy cow during simulation will also move in the direction depends on your incentives. So this is a technical split. So, and this, so that's why also this 10,000, this is a, it's a calculated number out of an average, and you have a distribution around that. So this is done for all the different animal activities, which are explicitly represented, but you also have hidden somewhere this kind of activity split for the crops. So that's why you can also see for price responses, yield changes on average. This is a technique normally used in LP. Okay, who, yes?
For me, the exercise was very fast. We did the whole coffee break exercise and it was still a problem. So could we at least go through quickly where the figures are? Because we just came until the rape yield and the rest, it's totally mystery for me.
Okay, good. So as we said, it's activity. Let's look at Komi. So I will share my screen. Hopefully it's... I will share my screen. So, so now we, you see some GEMS code again, So. So yeah, so it was this file. You have created with the script, so cut it out, so to say, as a data cube. We can reset it here. So you see that this particular one regions, and this is in 2030 in the baseline. So we have first is a column. And this is now ordered. You can sort that here if you want. We can sort the different dimensions. Yeah. We try not to sort. How can I remove that sorting?
Cancel.
None.
No.
Okay, like this, no. Maybe I have to restart it again so that it's, it looks exactly as in your case. So, it's remembering the sorting. Okay, so this is the activity. So if you have decal, so here's a search field, so then we have the activities here. Huh? So, and here we have COMI, so which is the product which is produced by different activities, as you see here. It's the different activities for cows. So we have high yield is this 10 tons, and we have 6.4 tons for low yield. Yeah. So this is the first question. So now, if we have an interest in finding, so to say, how many 1,000 cows are in these regions available, we have to look at levels. So these are these cows, these numbers here. Yeah. Then we have the cross, so growth, so the total production for, what was it? Cow milk. Yeah. So if you look for that and you look then for this COMI, under C, O, O, C, COMI, here. So you have the total production in 1,000 tons here, and what is used for feeding. So is it the correct way? Yeah, okay. And then we look again, decal, what was it? So the culls, yeah? Which a cow is needed. So it's the input. It's a pity that's now a bit sorted differently. I do not know why this is storing this sorting. So, and there's a young animal, it's called calf, yeah? And you see that here, this is also a technical terms that we can multiply everything together, yeah? So it's 0.4. So we need, on average, we need less than half a cow to replace that dairy cow. Yeah, and this is of course the same because it is completely independent of the yield of the cow. Yeah, and this is here done for females, and this is also for males. These are the numbers. Yeah. And the number of days a pig is produced for fattening. So then we have the activities in the columns, pig for fattening, pig fattening, yeah. And there's a day here, the days. So yeah, it requires 121 days to finalize before you slaughter the pig. This exercise, of course, is something that you are, I mean, what you learn should learn here, yeah? That you have a column and you have activities and you have products. And as you see, it's not so easy to look in GEMS into a description in the database, yeah, because it's mainly storing just data and acronyms. So these kind of set elements here. Yeah? The nice thing here is that we can easily navigate and load in less than seconds, yeah, this kind of database in and out. That's why Capri is so fast. Yeah, I mean, we had once a colleague who tried to put it in a normal database structure or an R. Yeah, so then Capri probably runs for a week, what we are doing maybe in a half an hour. Yeah, so but this comes to some costs, and the costs are clearly here defined. Yeah, it's difficult to understand as a newcomer. Without knowing, so to say, how is the structure of this data cube, yeah, where these numbers are stored. So that's why it's not that you should learn in this course to find exactly each number, but you get now with this exercise a feeling, yeah, how you can access the different numbers we are using for the supply module. And interestingly, I mean, if you have once done it, yeah, I mean, if we have a PhD course. So what we are doing then is more or less identifying all the different parameters who are coming in, because they are also parameters in our models. And if we modify that, yeah. So what we have done yesterday with an increase of yield. So what we are doing is nothing else that we apply a certain factor. It was SoftWheat yesterday. Yeah. So we have SoftWheat. Review. David, is it possible to get this sorting here back? I do not know.
You can reset it maybe. Let me tell that.
Is it then the sorting? No, it's still. I will close everything and open it again. I don't think that it's. Yes, I will remove. Now it's a classical one. Sorry. Now it's the same as you. And what we have done yesterday is that we have the activity here in column. So soft wheat production, and this is producing wheat, and it's also producing straw somewhere. We'll see that as a product here, because there's an indicator somewhere here, straw, yeah? So which is produced also in tons, yeah? And when you modify these simple scenarios or applications, increase prices, yields, change maybe the replacement rate for cows, or we have a lot of other indicators we have seen now, the pesticide costs and so on. This can be by just modifying the numbers here in this data cube. And then you push that into your supply modules, and it reacts to a certain way and then interacts with the market model and so on. So this was the idea that you are getting a feeling. So where this data that first, the data exists, that we have a structure of the data cube, and that, of course, it's not so easy. There is not a clear and full explanation as in the full-fledged database. But the reason is that Capri needs to have a technical implementation that it runs fast, yeah, because we have millions of data. Any other questions to this exercise? Is there someone who has not, who was not able to execute the script and open the data? So it worked for all, yeah?